Our Old Testament lesson today comes from the Sauser. I'll be reading Psalm number 22. There are many persons, myself included, who believe that Jesus prayed this psalm while he was hanging on the cross. Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me? Enthroned on the praises of Israel, and you, our ancestors, trusted. They trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I'm a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. Shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in any delight. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth. Since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near. To help. Many bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening and roaring lion. I'm poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It's melted within my breast. My mouth is dried out like a potsherd. My tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me down in the dust of death. A company of evildoers encircles me. My hands and feet have shriveled. I can count all my bones. They stare and they gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves. For my clothing they cast lots. But you, Lord, do not be far away. Oh, my God. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog, save me from the mouth of the lion. From the horns of the wild oxen you have rescued me. I will tell of your name to my brothers and sisters in the midst of the congregation. I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. And all your offspring of Jacob, glorify him, and stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For he did not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted. He did not hide his face from me, but he heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of the nations shall worship before him, for dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over all the nations. To him indeed shall all go down. Verses 13 through 18. Now, who are you if you're eager to do what's good? But even if you do suffer for doing what's right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear. Do not be intimidated, but in your hearts, sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and reverence. Keep your conscience clear, so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it's better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous, the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the Lord, in the Spirit, in the flesh. But he was made alive in the Spirit. Amen. Put to death in the flesh, made alive in the Spirit forever. St. Peter has written us a beautiful letter telling us to abound in hope because the end of all things is near. Yes, he tells us the kingdom of heaven on earth is near. When our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will usher in a new creation and wipe away every tear from our eyes. We see signs even now, he tells us, of Christ's kingship on earth. Signs even now. But until that day, Peter teaches us, even though we are true citizens of the kingdom of heaven, we must live as exiles in the present kingdom of Satan. Peter implores us to accept our current condition as exiles and slaves in this kingdom of evil, knowing that Christ is coming to release us from bondage. That is our hope, our faith, and our truth. Till that day, the Apostle Peter says, we must live in holiness, abide in hope, and tend to the flock of Jesus Christ. We must be good stewards of God's grace, setting godly examples for others to follow. So yes, we must endure our present suffering for now, knowing that Jesus also suffered on our behalf, that we may be set free forevermore. In fact, you see, Jesus is the perfect example of how to suffer for the sake of God. For it's through his suffering that we are saved, reconciled, atoned to God. His suffering sets us free to be true citizens of the kingdom of heaven, even while we're exiles in the kingdom of Satan. Peter teaches us the truth. As long as we are exiles in this kingdom of Satan, this fallen world, we will experience suffering. It's how we endure that suffering that sets us apart as Christians, because we suffer in the certain hope of the coming of the kingdom of heaven on earth, when all of us are united under the loving rule of the Son of God. We're to spread this message throughout the world because we are Christ's ambassadors. We are the holy priesthood, those who teach others how to live in faith, peace, and grace, even though now we are living in a kingdom of sin. That brings us to the point of today's sermon. At one time or another, each of us will suffer. Suffering is a part of life, and to each life it will come. Suffering may come in the form of grief over the loss of a friend or a loved one, grief over missed opportunities or broken relationships, even grief over watching another suffer. friendships which did not last, family relationships irreparably harmed through thoughtless words and deeds. Suffering may be in the form of mental anguish, physical addiction, fear, anxiety, or unbearable stress. Suffering may come in the form of guilt or shame. Some of us are haunted even now, bearing guilt over actions which took place years ago, actions for which we are now ashamed. Suffering may come as a result of acts of war or acts of nature. Homes are lost, property is destroyed, lives are taken. Windstorms, sea storms, fires, floods, earthquakes, wars, and rumors of wars. We face these as part of our human existence. Suffering may come from accidental occurrences. Airplanes fall from the sky, trains are derailed, drivers lose control of their automobiles, firearms are discharged, barges strike bridges. Sometimes we suffer in empathy, sharing the sorrow of those near or far who are suffering at the hands of sickness, grief, despair, loneliness, heartache, desolation. Suffering is a part of the human experience. All of us must face suffering during our lives, and some of us must face what seems to be far more than their fair share. Does God want us to suffer? No. Does God intend for us to suffer? No. Does God somehow gain a perverse sense of pleasure from watching us suffer? No, 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 no. A thousand times, no. God takes no pleasure from seeing us in pain. Nor does God intend for us to suffer. Suffering is a natural consequence of God's good creation and an unnatural consequence of sin, our disobedience to God. See, the wonderful world that God has given us in which to live is governed by physical laws, wind and tide, storm and sunshine, the cycle of life and death. These are part of the created world. The same God who endowed us with reason also gave to human beings real human emotions, joy, love, grief, sorrow, guilt, pleasure, shame, delight, anger, pathos. The list goes on and on. Our denomination holds that it is the chief purpose of humankind to glorify God and enjoy God forever. Our Creator endowed us with human emotions and human strengths and frailties, such that we may meet this purpose, such that we may indeed glorify and enjoy God. We have the ability to think and to make choices. Sometimes we make poor choices. We sin by violating God's commandments and plans for our life. Yet God loves us still. Hear that. God loves us still. Yet God reaches out to us even now in all our sin and sorrow and says, "Follow me. You are forgiven. You are mine. I have redeemed you." St. Peter, oh, St. Peter knew about sin, didn't he? St. Peter knew about sin. St. Peter knew about guilt and shame, and St. Peter knew what it was like to choose to deny God. Deny God thrice, even on the night that Jesus was betrayed. But St. Peter also knew about forgiveness and redemption and the balance Do not be intimidated, but in your hearts sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is within you. Yet do it with gentleness and reverence. Keep your conscience clear, so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ will be put to shame. For it's better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. Let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, a criminal, or even as a mischiefmaker. Yet if any of you suffers as a Christian, do not consider it a disgrace, but glorify God because you bear his name. Rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you also may be glad and shout for joy when his name is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed. You are blessed because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. No doubt, similar are Peter's words to those of another who was very familiar with suffering. Here's St. Paul's words addressed to the Romans, the words with which we call ourselves to worship. This morning, this is Romans 5, 3 through 5. We boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us because God's hope has been poured in our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. To suffer is to be truly human, and to suffer for Christ's sake is divine. For such suffering glorifies God. No, God does not desire for us needless suffering, nor does God take pleasure in knowing that we are feeling pain, but God understands our suffering. God empathizes with our suffering. God has experienced our suffering. Think about this, grief. Oh yes, the shortest, yet perhaps most poignant verse in the Bible is John 11:35. Jesus wept. When he visited the grave of his dead friend Lazarus, Jesus wept, knowing that he had the power to raise Lazarus from the dead, even knowing that he would indeed raise Lazarus from the dead, as he raises each one of us from death. Jesus still wept. Alongside Mary and Martha and the other mourners, Jesus felt grief, and he wept. Loneliness, how must Jesus have felt when his disciples, even the faithful disciple Peter, departed from him and left him alone to face his persecutors on the night that he was betrayed? Physical pain? Think of the 40 lashes, the crown of thorns, the 3 nails driven into his flesh, the agony of the cross, the spear thrust into his side, his parching thirst, abandonment. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? And yet he endured. And yet Jesus endured all the suffering that human misery can experience, and thus he glorified God and purchased our freedom. The suffering servant of Isaiah, the Messiah of whom we read in unison this morning, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, our God experienced the greatest depths of human suffering so that we may be saved. He gave his life that we may live with him for all eternity. Says Isaiah in chapters 52 and 53 of the Messiah, his appearance was marred beyond human semblance. He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with griefs, wounded for our transgressions, righteous. My servant made many accounted righteous. He shall bear their iniquities, because he poured out his soul to death. He was numbered with the transgressors, and yet he bore the sins of many, and he made intercession with the transgressors. Peter tells us that when we suffer, as most assuredly we will, we should take for our example our Lord Jesus himself. Writes Peter in his first epistle to all of us who suffer. Christ also suffered for sins once for all. The righteous for the unrighteous in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh but made alive in the spirit. If you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have come, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you should follow in his steps. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten. But he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins, we might live righteousness. By his wounds you've been healed, for you were going astray like sheep. But now you have returned to the shepherd and the guardian of your souls. Jesus never promised us that we would be free from suffering on this earth. Quite the contrary, he teaches us everyone's going through a refining fire sooner or later, which you'll be preserved, protected from the eternal flames. Be preservatives of yourselves. Preserve your peace. That's Mark 9:49-50, as translated by Peterson in the Message. We are made in God's image, and we, like God, may suffer to make us fully human. God gave us the capacity to feel suffering just as he feels suffering. And as did Jesus, he may use our suffering for the glory of God. Is it comforting to us to know that when we are suffering, God too has the capacity to suffer, and thus can truly empathize with us and suffer alongside us? I think it's comforting to know when we are suffering, God too has the capacity to suffer. God truly empathizes with us and suffers alongside us. God is not a shielded God who's never felt pain and been exposed to suffering. Ours is a God who's experienced the ultimate in heartache and suffering, but has used even suffering to the glory of God. Even in his suffering, even through his suffering, our Lord Jesus Christ poured out his mercy upon us all. With the writer of Hebrews, we can proclaim with wonder and reverence, it was fitting that God, for whom men Mighty God, give us such a vision of your purpose and such an assurance of your love and power that we may ever hold fast the hope which is in Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you.